Welcome to Chalk Talk, Danville Public Schools weekly news magazine. I'm Diane Locker, your host. We're here in front of what we all know is that's a big yellow school bus. What we're doing this week is we're at the Danville Public Schools Transportation Department to talk about the buses, to talk about the new code of conduct, and find out what safety features are on these buses to protect your children. We're going to kick the show off by going inside and having a conversation with Mike Adkins, who is the Director of Transportation Services. So follow me now as we go inside and have a conversation with the Director of Transportation. Mike, first thing I want to ask you about the buses, this is the obvious question. How many buses do we have?
As far as the buses that we have around 70 buses. On a typical day, we run about 57 buses on our routes, and the rest are held back as spare buses to replace any buses that we may have with breakdowns or that need service.
Now, I'm going back in my memory here, but there are two types of buses. You've got the buses that transport the children to and from school, but don't we have something that's called activity buses also?
We do. We have three dedicated activity buses, and those buses are strictly used to transport sports teams or classes to go to places like Owens Farm, those type areas for the children. And those buses are painted white, and they don't typically have the same equipment on them as a regular school bus.
Now, when you talk about going to Owens Farm and things like that, I think the way that we usually refer to that is to use them for field trips.
Exactly, yes.
Now, those buses that I've been noticing buses lately that seem to be shaped a little bit different than school buses always were, do we have new buses or are we replacing our buses? What is the age of the buses that you have on the street right now?
Well, we do have quite a few newer buses than what we used to have. The newer buses are shaped a bit differently. They're built larger than the older buses, and they're also they have different inside as far as the way they're built inside. They have taller seats for more protection. The older buses that we have are very good buses. They're maintained very well, and they're taken care of very well. But the average age of our bus is probably, I would guesstimate now, between 8 and 9 years old. We have some buses that are running that are as old as 15 years old, and we have our newer buses about 2 or 3 years old.
Kind of answered. I was going to say, what is the life of a bus? But according to what you're saying there, with good maintenance and everything, we have them on up to 15 years?
That's correct. As long as the bus meets the state-mandated safety requirements, you can use the bus in perpetuity. We typically like to try to upgrade as much as we can because buses are just like automobiles. They get older, and it costs more to keep them running and to keep them properly maintained. But we're very fortunate. We have a very good service department with two service technicians that take care of them.
I was going to ask you, when you said the proper maintenance and that type of thing. Now, when we think of transportation and we think of the school system, we think of the yellow school bus running around. But you've got drivers that of the buses, but don't you also have maintenance that's taken care of right here at the transportation department?
Yes, we maintain all our buses now. There are certain things that we have to send them back to the dealer for because we don't have the equipment to do the certain repairs, but the majority of the work is done right here on site by our own school-employed service technicians.
How many bus drivers do we have?
If you count our substitute bus drivers as well as our regular bus drivers, we probably have around 80 to 85 drivers.
Maintenance people do? And when I say maintenance, I'm talking about just maintenance of the buses. How many people are involved in that?
We have two.
And they're keeping all those buses going?
They do. And the state of Virginia, the Department of Education for the state of Virginia, mandates that we have a regular schedule of maintenance. Every bus that we have comes into our service department and is inspected by our service technicians about every 28 school days. There's a certain procedure that has to be followed that the state mandates, and paperwork has to be done and has to be signed off on. So every bus is checked on a regular basis.
We're going to talk a little bit more about the buses after the break because we're going to actually get down and get in a bus and talk about some of the new features on the bus and a lot of the safety features. But I want to talk about the code of conduct. I don't think there's anyone out there that doesn't know that we have a student code of conduct. I mean, we know what that is. But I think we've got something this year that we have just instituted, and that's going to be a code of conduct on buses. Now, what's different about a code of conduct on a bus and the code of conduct, let's say, in the classrooms?
Well, what we wanted to achieve with a code of conduct for the school bus was to be able to align our schools across the district. We wanted our principals to be able to have some type of a tool to be able to look at things that children were doing on the buses and to be able to deal with these situations in a way that was consistent from school to school, from pre-K all the way to high school.
Let's clarify something for the community. Without having, let's say, a code of conduct on the buses, we have the bus driver, and we have a bus full of children. Approximately how many children on a bus?
On average, you'll see about 40 kids on a bus.
So we have those 40 kids on the bus. There is no, from school to school, each principal might treat an infraction in a different way. The code of conduct is going to say, if this happens, this is the result. Is that the way it's going to work?
Yes. What principals now will have is a tool that will tell them, based on what the infraction is, what the consequence should be. It will tell them how many referrals a child can have before very serious action is taken, such as removal from the bus. But what makes this different than you find in most schools is we have built into this something we call a redemption clause. This redemption clause mandates parent conferences after so many referrals. And at that point, the parent must come in and meet with the principal or either meet with him by telephone. Why we want to do this is we believe that we must have parental engagement to be able to change the behavior of the children. So with bringing the parent in on this at an early stage, hopefully we can change the behavior of the child. We want them to ride the bus. We just want them to behave because it's very, very difficult for the drivers to be able to maintain safety on that bus when the kids are out of control.
I think that every parent that's ever driven around in a car with children in the back seat knows what it's like to try to keep your eye on the road but also keep up with what's going on back there. So if you could take that and kind of multiply it from those two or three children you have in the back seat to the 40 children that are on a bus, makes it very difficult for the driver. And I think behavior might be a little bit different on the bus than a classroom. Do you agree with that?
Well, it can be, especially when you consider that typically in a classroom you have 20 to 25 kids all the same grade level, whereas a school bus driver may have 40 to 45 to 50 kids of all different grade levels who haven't really seen each other all day, so they tend to be a little bit more active on the school bus than what they are in the classroom.
But I think it's also important to say that when I've got that 25, 30 kids in a classroom, I've got a teacher that's got their eyes on them. On a bus, the bus driver has their back to them.
Well, that's true. A teacher is facing the children typically, and they're in one location, and they're still, whereas a bus driver has their back to the children, and they're navigating a 26,000-pound, 40-feet-long bus through narrow streets with construction. So there's a big difference in that environment.
Now, have the parents in our community been notified of this code of conduct that we now have?
They have. The bus code of conduct is actually attached to the student code of conduct. That goes out every year to the parents from the schools. And in the package that goes out is the bus code of conduct along with a bus contract that both the parent and the student are required to sign and return back to the school, saying that they understand what the bus rules are and what the consequences could be.
One of the things that I think sometimes gets a little bit confusing, and it's the way we use our buses. Let's say on a typical morning, I think you make a run, let's say we talked a little bit earlier and you said you make a run for middle school. So we deliver our middle school students. Then you do a run for elementary, and then you do a run for high school. Is that the way it works? And the times of the schools are staggered so that it enables you to do that?
We do. We have 4 bell schedules. Typically, our first bell schedule in the morning is for the middle school.
What's the earliest that you pick up in the morning?
We start picking up kids around 6:40 as far as the regular school buses. They will usually drop the children off at the middle schools around 7:05, and then they will leave and they'll start their second run, which will cover a few of the elementary schools and our John M. Langston Focus School. Once they drop off around 7:35, then they'll start their third run, and that covers George Washington High School and Galileo High School. that run usually, typically, they drop off between 8:10 and 8:20. After that, we start our fourth run, and that will pick up Johnson Elementary. It will pick up the Grove Park pre-K, and it also picks up the Gibson Elementary School students.
So the same thing would happen in reverse in the afternoon. The middle school kids would be picked up, carried home earlier, and so on and so forth. What's the latest drop-off that you have in the afternoon?
Once we get everything on schedule and get everything worked out, usually the last children are usually dropped off in the neighborhood of around 4:30 to 20 of 5. It really depends on when we drop off our pre-K children, many times the parents are not there for them. So the bus may have to circle around several times. In some cases, they have to take them back to school. But usually around 4:30 is when the last children are dropped off.
Let me ask you something. What if you've got a bus stop, and you've got all these different kids coming to the bus stop, but my child is sick today and is not going to be at the bus stop? What does the bus driver do? Do they wait, or should they tell the bus driver? What happens in that case?
Some parents will call and tell us that their child is not going to school that day. Bus drivers, as the year goes along, they tend to learn their children. But if you have a community stop where you have maybe 6-7 children that are walking from all different directions to the bus stop, once the bus gets there and picks the children up, they don't typically wait. If the children are not at the bus stop, or if they don't see them coming to the bus stop relatively quickly, then the bus will go ahead and move on to the next stop. Then it becomes the responsibility of the parent to get them to school.
We've talked about the code of conduct and being safe on the bus, and what I want to do now is we're going to go take a short break. When we come back from the break, I want you to take me down to a bus, and I want to talk about some of the really unique features that we have on our buses and some of the new things, and one of those is a stop sign camera, and I think that's going to be very interesting to a lot of people. Be sure to come back after the break, because we're going to get down and we're going to go through a bus, and we're going to show you all of the things on that bus that are there just to make things safer for the children.
Having devices in my classroom helps foster an engaging atmosphere for my students. They're having to get a topic, research the topic, and then create an assignment using that topic. The students are more engaged on the devices because they're having to work in a collaborative group. They're having to research a topic and then create something for that assignment. Danville Public Schools wants our students to be on the cutting edge of technology as we prepare our students for an ever-changing economy.
Mike, now we're getting on a bus, just like some of the students might be coming onto the bus. I think one of the things that's very important is the cameras. And I remember you and I talked in the past about the cameras, but I'd like to point them out again for the parents out in the community to see just how these cameras work and what they're taking a picture of.
Okay, all of our buses are equipped with 3 digital cameras. You can see a camera here, which is at the front of the bus that looks towards the rear. We have a camera also here that's mounted just above the driver. They can see the driver and what the driver's doing. It also allows us to see outside of the bus through the entrance door. And then we also have a camera at the very rear of the bus that looks from the rear of the bus forward. Now, all these cameras are digital, meaning that they have a hard drive, just like a computer, and those images go in. And once we have those images recorded, if a school requests a video of what happened on the bus that day, we can download that video onto our computer and send it directly to the school, to their computer, eliminating the need for carrying videotapes and that type thing to the schools.
Well, that also will support your code of conduct, won't it? Because if you say there was an infraction on the bus, here's what it was, here's what it looks like.
Well, part of our job is to provide support to the schools. Matter of fact, our entire job is to provide support to the students and to the schools. So if a school administrator has a referral on a child and they need to see what happened with their own eyes, they can request to see the video. We can pull that and download it directly to their computer. One of the other things that this camera system does for us as well is it gives us a passive GPS tracking system. What that means is once the bus comes back to the bus lot, we can take the hard drive out of the computer that records the camera footage.
Now, are you saying there's a computer in the bus?
Yes. Yes, it is. It's part of the camera system. It's mounted where you can't see it, but it has a hard drive. We pull that hard drive out of that computer, and we put it on our hook it into our computers upstairs, and we can actually see the video footage as well as a map that shows exactly where the bus goes, where it stops, what time it stops there. It also tells us the speed the bus goes. It tells us if all the safety equipment was used, if signal lights were used, when the brake lights came on. All the telemetry of the bus is recorded for us to see.
That also, not only does all of those things support the code of conduct, that supports the fact that the bus has an accident, maybe the circumstances of the accident or the safety features and that type of thing.
It does. It does a lot of things. It tells us if the bus is following the route. It tells us all the things you mentioned. It also helps us to understand if a parent calls and says the bus didn't come by my stop, or the bus was late, or I haven't seen the bus, then we can go and pull this telemetry and we can see exactly where the bus was, what time it was there, and if it stopped.
You mentioned something when we were talking earlier about the heights of the seats, the seat backs. What is that you were talking about?
Well, as most people know, and it's been a topic of conversation for several years, school buses do not have seat belts as a rule. School buses are designed with what we call seat compartmentalization. The seats are designed to be a specific distance apart from each other, and the backs of the seats are designed to be a specific height.
Now, this, you mean this?
Yes. This part here is a certain height.
It's also soft.
It is. If there's an impact, a frontal impact, a rear impact, or a side impact, these seats are designed so that if kids move, they're designed to move very little or to hit against something that's soft. This is all designed by experts and engineers over the years to determine what's best for the children.
I was going to say, if you get on an older school bus, the backs were usually about level with the lower part of that window there.
Yeah, some of the buses from back in the early 70s and 60s, some of them actually had a metal bar across the top.
Yeah.
And over the years, that's all changed, and we've gone to these nice, soft, high seat backs so that if children do go forward or backwards, they have something soft that they contact.
Now, I'm looking at this the aisle here. If this were a Greyhound bus or a bus, an airplane or whatever, it would be wider than this, I think. This to me looks like it's more the size of a student.
Yes, it's just wide enough for students to go in and out. And there again, that's part of the seat design for safety. They want to minimize the amount of area where flying objects could happen or where students could be out in the aisles. So you'll see the seats are wider and the aisleway is more narrow, and that's all part of the safety design of the school bus.
What I'd like to do now is get out and see some of the things on the outside of the bus. Anything else you wanted to point out in here before we move outside?
Only one other thing. All of our buses are equipped with what we call a child reminder system. What that does is that requires the bus driver to check their bus before they get off the bus to make sure there aren't any students that may have fallen asleep or for whatever reason were still on the bus.
I think that's part of that. We were outside, and I heard a very loud horn beeping. Is that the alarm system?
It is, and basically how it works is when the bus driver parks their bus, before they can exit the bus, once they turn the bus off, they must go to the rear of the bus and deactivate the child reminder system. If they do not, once they open the entrance door, the horn will start to blow and continue to blow until they come in and go back and deactivate.
Okay, now I think I understand this. You said that earlier, and I didn't quite get it, but I'm a bus driver. I've been through my run. I'm getting ready to park the bus here, go get in my car, and go home. You're saying that I've got to walk to the back of this bus and deactivate that alarm, or I can't get out of the bus without the alarm going off.
That's exactly right.
And if you force me to walk to the back of the bus, I'm going to see if anybody's fallen asleep or is still on the bus.
That's the idea. We want the drivers to go to the rear of the bus so that they can see their seats and deactivate that alarm. With that horn blowing, if they forget to do that, it reminds them so that they can go back, deactivate, then get off the bus so the horn will stop blowing.
It's a very loud horn, too. Take me outside now and show me some of the things that have been added, especially this stop sign camera. Mike, the first thing I'd like to do is take a look at this bar right here.
Okay, this bar is actually a safety bar that's required on all school buses in the state of Virginia. The function of this bar is to make sure that the children, when they cross in front of the bus, go out far enough where the bus driver can see them. Sometimes with the little ones, if they go too close to the front of the bus driver couldn't see them.
You know, that's remarkable. Let's walk over here a little bit, because I just thought this was here to stop children. I did not realize there's an importance to the length of it so that you can see, the driver can see.
Absolutely. By having the children walk out past the bar, now the bus driver has a clear sight where they can see them. And with the very, very small children, who may not be but this tall, if they walk directly in front of the bus driver may not could see them and then could pull off with the child in front of the bus.
Now, does this bar come out automatically when that door opens, or does the driver determine when this bar comes out?
No, the way the system is set up, as soon as that door opens, this bar automatically comes out, as well as a stop sign that we'll see in just a minute. It automatically deploys as well.
When this is deployed, the stop signs on the side deploy.
That's correct. And also, if you'll see at the top of the bus, you'll see some red lights that are flashing. That lets people know they need to stop.
Okay. Red lights mean you stop, and then the stop signs come out. That means you stop. And we've got a child probably walking across. Mm-hmm. What does it mean? And I've seen buses stopped with just those yellow lights going. What does that mean?
The yellow lights are what we call warning lights. There's a switch inside the bus that the driver activates when they're approximately 100 feet from the stop. Those yellow lights flash to let traffic know I'm getting ready to make a stop so that they can slow down and be prepared for that stop. Once the bus comes to a stop and that door is open, then it automatically goes to the red flashing lights and then deploys the arm and the stop sign.
Is it not against the law to pass a bus with these red lights flashing?
It is against the law to pass a bus with red lights flashing unless you're on a divided highway with a physical barrier between the lanes.
That means
it could be a grass island or it could be a concrete barrier, but there has to be a physical barrier between the lanes.
What I want to do now is I want to go around to this side of the bus, take a look at that stop sign, but I want you to show us something that's new this year, and that's our stop sign camera. Let's go around here. Mike, the sign that's flashing right here. Now, what we just said is when that bar comes out, this light comes out, the red lights are flashing, you no longer pass this bus, because that means that students are maybe coming around in front of you.
Yes, once that stop sign comes out, you'll see the red lights flashing, you'll see it says stop. Traffic in both directions must stop until that bus driver determines whether or not a child's going to unload from the bus or be loaded on the bus. And they cannot move until the bus driver retracts that stop sign, the lights go out, and everything is back to normal. Then the traffic can move.
Let's say I'm out there driving and I'm just not paying attention, or maybe I don't care. Now, what have we got new this year that's going to tell you if I'm still going to pass even with all these red lights going?
Well, we do have something new. We're in the process of trying to equip as many buses as we can. It's called a stop sign camera, and it's a camera that's located on the school bus directly under the stop sign, and it looks forward and it looks rearward.
Is this the small white box down here?
Yes, it's right below the stop sign on the bus body. And that camera will activate the instant that the stop sign deploys.
Now, did you say it looks forward of the bus and it also looks to the rear of the bus?
Yes, it will record footage of any approaching traffic if it passes the bus, and will also record any traffic behind the bus that may go by the bus that's going in the same direction the bus is in. So it actually is two cameras, and it records traffic coming in both directions.
Well, I might say, you don't know who I am, and you don't know my car, but you're going to have a copy of my license plate, aren't you?
Yes, and the Danville Police Department is very kind in working with us. If we provide them with a CD or video camera footage of the vehicle with the license plate number, then they can help us pursue a warrant and bring the folks to court. And whoever the car is registered to is who's responsible.
That's amazing, and I think it's very important. I think that we should say to everyone out there, when you think about passing that bus now, that little white box is going to get you coming and going, so remember that. Now, Mike, I appreciate everything that you've told us today, but I think there's one other thing that we might want to say to the community. What if we don't know I'm new to the community, or this is the beginning of the year, or for some reason we move. There's some changes during the year. How do I find out where a bus stop is and what bus my child should be on?
Well, our bus information now, bus stops, bus routes, all of those type things are now done by computer and satellite. The first thing that has to happen is parents need to make sure that they contact their schools, make sure they have the correct address, because the bus stop information, the bus routing information is based on what the home address is of the child. Now, if you register your child in school, or if you move to a different school district and register your child, once that information goes into the school database, it usually takes us 24 to 48 hours to be able to assign bus transportation. All of our information comes directly from the school database, so it's important that it's correct there.
Can I go online and get this information?
No, you can't go online and get it, but you can call your school. Your school has access to our system where they can look up the information and give that to you, or you can call Transportation Services.
And I think that telephone number is on the screen right now. I want to thank you for, first off, for all the things you do. I think it's we take for granted that the bus shows up, and we don't realize all the work that goes behind that. And I think the safety features over the years have really, really improved from the inside of the bus, certainly to the outside of the bus, and to this unique little camera down here, too. So thanks for taking time out to talk with us this week.
Thank you very much. We appreciate you coming down.
When you see that bus coming by now, you know all of the things that we've done here in Danville Public School to make that as safe as we can possibly make it, inside the bus, outside the bus. We want to thank you for spending time with us this week, and be sure to come back next week to find out what's going on in Danville Public Schools.